For over two centuries, neither Russian nor Soviet historians had mentioned the name of the disciple and successor to the causes fought for by Hetman Ivan Mazepa, one of the most prominent Ukrainian political figures of the Cossack era, Pylyp Orlyk. Back in the day, the Turkish Sultan and the Crimean Khan, the monarchs of Sweden, England, France, Poland, and other European countries, knew him personally. Pylyp Orlyk occupies a special place among the Ukrainian Hetmans since he was elected and acted in exile. His merit was the drawing up of an agreement with the Cossacks, which became known in history as the first constitution of the Ukrainian state. The figure of Pylyp Orlyk is unique not just in the history of Ukraine, but also in European and world history. It is primarily unique due to the fact that there were many paradoxes in his life. A man who was born and died outside of Ukraine is basically the one and only fighter for the freedom of the Ukrainian state, as well as the constitutional justification of that in the international dimension. It is worth mentioning that the collisions that occurred in his fate truly deserve a separate story. I think that the figure of Pylyp Orlyk is still underestimated. Also, due to falsifications, as well as political and patriotic reasons that sometimes impede the reproduction of the actual course of events and avoiding mythologization. The uniqueness of Pylyp Orlyk lies in the fact that, unlike many of his predecessors, he truly fought for the idea. In addition, his constitution, strategy and tactics in the creation of an independent Ukrainian state were not based on selfish interests. For a long time, the name of Pylyp Orlyk was silenced not only because he was a friend of Ivan Mazepa, who was branded a traitor, but also because he was the first Ukrainian political emigrant. It is clear that he was stripped out of the political process. If we take Soviet historiography of the 20th century as an example, Ukrainian political emigration after the first and second liberation struggle was dangerous for the Soviet Union. Clearly, there was no reason for imperial historiography to emphasize the fact of Ukrainian political emigration in the 18th century more than they had to. Therefore, it was easier to simply silence that. Thus, the figure of Pylyp Orlyk seemed to just appear from nowhere in 1991. Ironically, Pylyp Orlyk, as one of the greatest patriots of his time, was not an ethnic Ukrainian. He was born in the autumn of 1672 to a Czech-Lithuanian gentry family on territory that is modern-day Belarus. Despite that, it is a kind of a paradox that a person who was not even an actual Ukrainian essentially personifies Ukraine as a nation. The worldview of the young Pylyp was influenced by his mother, who was an Orthodox Christian. The famous church and cultural Ukrainian figure Stefan Yavorsky was his mentor and patron saint during his studies at the Kyiv Mohyla Academy. It was he who arranged for the young nobleman to work at the Kyiv Metropolitan Office after graduation. In 1700, Orlyk moved to the General Military Office, to the post of Senior Military Clerk. That was the leading body of then Cossack state. It can be compared to the present Cabinet of Ministers of Ukraine. He started work there as a military clerk. Then he was promoted to a regent, which is basically an affairs manager. This appointment became possible not just due to Orlyk's devotion to the cause, but also thanks to his natural giftedness, sharp mind, and diligence in his studies. According to his contemporaries, he knew many foreign languages. Orlyk knew many foreign languages. He probably knew six, maybe eight languages. It's hard to say which of those he learned in his youth and which he was forced to learn later when he wandered through foreign lands. But the fact is that he learned Latin well during his studies, which was the main language of international communication, education and science in the Baroque Europe of the time. In 1707, Orlyk became General Secretary to Ivan Mazepa. According to his instructions, he conducted secret diplomatic correspondence with representatives of Polish and Swedish political circles. It was then that he swore allegiance to the Hetman in his quest to achieve the independence of Ukraine with the help of the Swedish kingdom. He kept true to the oath until the end of his life, but the attempt to free Ukraine from Russian rule in 1709 proved unsuccessful. After the defeat of the army of Charles XII near Poltava, Orlyk, along with the Hetman's loyal troops, left Ukraine and moved to the territory of the Moldavian Principality under the rule of the Turkish Sultan. Overwhelmed by the defeat, the Ukrainian Hetman died less than 3 months later. In April 1710, Pylyp Orlyk was elected Hetman of Ukraine in exile. Orlyk was elected Hetman in exile, and he continued the causes of his teacher and father. It is hardly ever mentioned these days, but the first problem faced by Pylyp Orlyk in emigration was the lack of funds for the upkeep of the Cossacks and continuing the struggle for a united Ukrainian state. The newly elected Hetman decided to solve this problem at the expense of his own fortunes. There was the issue of power and money. First of all, a new Hetman had to be chosen after the death of Mazepa. Secondly, his treasure had to be distributed. There, the fate was such that Orlyk was left without that source. The thing is that Mazepa was the richest man in Ukraine. And according to the estimates of modern historians, his wealth together with the military treasury amounted to a considerable sum. Approximately 1.2 million of Swedish dollars. But the International Commission agreed on the fact that that money, so necessary for the development of the Ukrainian patriotic idea, was inherited by his nephew Andriy Voinarovsky. Pylyp Orlyk was essentially left with no money. He was forced to fund the whole thing out of his own pocket. He and his family were forced to spend their lives in exile in poverty. It got so bad that he had to look for money so that his wife would not be put in prison for debts. After being elected Hetman, an agreement was concluded between Pylyp Orlyk and the Cossack elders, which not only regulated the relations between them, but also constituted the internal structure of the Hetman state. The document written by Orlyk was called the Covenants and Constitutions of the Laws and Liberties of the Zaporizhian Army, and was essentially the first constitution of the Ukrainian state. The constitution of Pylyp Orlyk was a very important legal state act of the 18th century. It was to a large extent progressive. For example, the issues of the division of power into three branches, legislative, executive, and judicial, were outlined, although vaguely. When European monarchs were imposing absolutism, trying to withdraw power from the legal field completely, like Louis XIV said shortly before that, "I'm the government." But Pylyp Orlyk voluntarily agreed to limit his power and outline the competencies. The frequent abuse of their authority by the Hetmans made Orlyk include articles in the document which can be considered as anti-corruption and aimed at establishing just and responsible government in the country. Basically, his articles normalized the democratic life in Ukraine. They contain many situations that are extremely relevant now, particularly the articles on fighting bribery. He took over that burden of power, as they were only interested in using their power to gain wealth, oppressing ordinary people. So what is written in those articles? It is impressive that at the stage of late feudalism and early capitalism, the constitution of Pylyp Orlyk had already determined social approaches to the life problems of the Ukrainian population. There's an important social segment, as we would call it, roughly between the 11th and the 16th articles. There he takes care of the common people and those who defend their homeland. Upon becoming Hetman, Orlyk began extensive diplomatic activity, aiming to release the divided and half Ukraine from the Russian and Polish dependence.
Pylyp Orlyk був справжнім майстром дипломатії.
Pylyp Orlyk was a true master of diplomacy. One of his well-known phrases is, "It is glorious not to kill people with steel, but to kill the war with words and solve all problems with the help of diplomacy." Essentially, those were the circumstances he was forced to act in, having neither money nor military strength.
Не маючи ні грошей, ні військової сили.
With the support of the Polish and French aristocrats, the Ukrainian Hetman succeeded in persuading the Turkish Sultan Ahmed III to go to war against Russia. In addition, Orlyk signed agreements on joint actions with the Swedish King Charles XII and the Crimean Khan Devlet Gyurei II. As a result, in January 1711, the United Ukrainian Tatar-Polish forces went on a military campaign to liberate right bank of Ukraine from Russia's presence. The operation by Orlyk was successful at first and led to the liberation of the right bank Ukraine. Orlyk gathered and created a coalition. These were the Crimean Tatars, the Poles who supported Stanislav Leszczynski, and the Zaporizhian Cossacks led by Orlyk. When Orlyk entered the territory of the left bank Ukraine, cities and villages surrendered without a fight. Their population and troops switched to his side. Ukrainians were waiting for liberation from the Russian regime. The terrible war crimes committed by Prince Menshikov in Baturin were still fresh in their memory. The murder of the whole populations of cities, the destruction of the Zaporizhia siege and cruel repressions against the Cossack elders that supported Mazepa. In March, almost the whole right bank Ukraine was under Orlyk's authority. Only Bila Tserkva ended up being impregnable. Several days of assaulting the well-fortified fortress with a considerable garrison gave no results. Unable to withstand the prolonged attack on Bila Tserkva, Orlyk's military coalition fell apart. The Tatars and the Poles left the battlefield, and Orlyk, with the Zaporizhians, were forced to retreat to Fostiv. Soon after, he left Ukraine and returned to Benderi. Convinced that he wouldn't be able to liberate Ukraine by military means, Orlyk began active diplomatic activity to create various interstate coalitions in order to liberate and restore a unified Ukrainian state. He turned to the European monarchs, the Pope, for support.
Його діяльність в еміграції
His activities in emigration led to the only unique fact we have after all this time. When, thanks to the actions of one person, the Ukrainian question, Ukrainian lands, were in the epicenter of the attention of European politics over the course of 30 years. Orlyk's active work abroad contributed to the gradual realization of European politicians and statesmen of the aspiration of Ukrainians to restore their own state. Here's what the King of France, Louis XV, wrote in 1733. I am very interested in the fate and the state of Mr. Orlyk. I think it is beneficial for France's interest to support Mr. Orlyk. It is necessary for the Ottoman Porta to help Hetman Orlyk to gather his own nation, so big and brave that it could overthrow Moscow's rule. It is clear that such active work on the part of Orlyk annoyed the Russian authorities and its leader, Peter I. He launched an actual hunt for the Ukrainian Hetman.
Orlyk до самої смерті Петра він був під загрозою поневолення. За
Orlyk was threatened with imprisonment up until the death of Peter. Pylyp Orlyk and his family were actually being hunted. We know how the special services of Peter I worked.
Очевидно, це було пов'язано з тим, що багато.
However, something went wrong in the case of Pylyp Orlyk. Apparently, that was due to the fact that many influential people in Europe, including the Austrian Emperor Charles VI and many others, were protecting Orlyk. He also tried to avoid being killed himself. Thanks to that, Peter's grasp did not reach him. Hetman Pylyp Orlyk died in the spring of 1742 in a foreign country, in Yasi, where he has found shelter. He died in poverty, but undefeated and unbroken in his desire to affirm the Ukrainian state. His cause was revived at the beginning of the 20th century, when the Ukrainian people proudly proclaimed their independence to the whole world, based on the heroic experience of their best representatives, people like Pylyp Orlyk.